In the beginning, Oakley had a vision. The world Oakley created has remained strong for decades, but the real world around it changed. With renewed focus on rebellious optimism in a fragmented world, Oakley evolved with purpose. It brought along new collaborators to extend these proofs of concepts into the hands of consumers. All along the way, they stayed true to that brand DNA. How'd they do it? This complex conversation is a unique masterclass about how Oakley innovated for the future while honoring the past. This is Future Genesis with your host, Aria Hughes.
How's everyone doing?
Good.
Amazing.
Thanks for having us.
Great.
I'm excited to have this conversation. So before we start, let's kind of set the foundation for Oakley. And Brian, I feel like you're the perfect person to do this. How long have you been at Oakley?
Been at Oakley now 25 years.
Wow. That's huge. So let's talk a little bit about Oakley, the history of it, the foundation, just like the primer, things people need to know.
You know, when I think people know Oakley as an eyewear brand, and a lot of people don't know that it actually started out as a business. Jim started selling motorcycle parts for other brands, and there's some things we talk about, the creeds behind Oakley. And so one of his things was everything in the world can and will become better. Just a matter of when and by whom. Until that time, motorcycle grips, BMX grips were basically just rubber tubes or sleeves that went on. And so he thought it should be more technical oriented. He developed Oakley, the Oakley grip, which now Oakley the brand was born. And so as you go through the history of it, you start to see goggles and things like that. But it was really the momentous part of it is when he got into eyewear. And so at that time, he was already making goggles. He lived here in Southern California. And you guys all know, like if you drive on PCH, the glare comes off the side of the water, the sun's setting. And he started to think, how come there isn't a pair of eyewear that has as much coverage as a goggle? And basically came back, made eye shades, and basically invented the sport performance eyewear market. And then as we go forward, you start to think about the momentous things he did to put Oakley onto the face, not just within sport performance, but even in lifestyle. And those styles that I think now the next generation of athletes and kids see of things like iJacket and X-Metals and Romeo and Juliet and Over the Top and Mars and Medusa and all these things that was really setting up the future of where we are now and really came to life in this piece we did called Max Fearlight.
So we're going to take things back a little bit more to 1991 with the iconic Max Fearlight commercial. So, I mean, first, before we play the commercial, who is Max Fearlight? Can you tell people?
So Max Fearlight was actually the name of the commercial, and there's a voiceover in it originally that talks about Max Fearlight was the time of day of something that happened where the sun was at its maximum point in the sky. And so one of the things we started to think about, Max Fearlight almost became this entity for us in a persona of its own of like, let's not just make it about this time of day. We can have actually give it a personality and make a person out of it. And so we really started to think about, as we were building for the future, let's go back and say, who was this character and what did he mean? And what is the story and his journey of it? And how does it mimic the course of the brand?
Let's watch the commercial. So cinematic. Kyle, talk about that a little bit. I mean, that was in 1991. Here we are in 2023. So kind of how do you use that as a foundation for what you're building on now?
The special thing about this commercial, Max Fearlight, is that to be such a big brand as Oakley, it's very hard for you to contextualize everything towards the same direction, vision. Everyone knows, and we all know Oakley, and Oakley, like it's inside our heads on our collective memory, as a brand that it's so much engraved into these aesthetics that actually, if you see something that it's Oakley, you don't even need a logo, to be honest. So we think that this commercial is very special because it brings everything together. It brings the aesthetics of the bunker. It brings the aesthetics of the product. It brings the personality of Max Freelight, that was a guy living by himself inside a bunker on a post-apocalyptic world. So this whole context as a brand is very powerful, because then when you are creating a product, actually you are giving the why to the product, and the product becomes an extension of what you see of that universe that it's on the screen. So this is a piece of art for us that we wanted to use as a foundation to build the brand forward, because it gave us the opportunity to have a very cohesive brand. You went to the store, crazy store. You went to the products, crazy product made out of metal, out of this world. And everything was very cohesive. So when we were thinking how we transition the brand forward, let's start by learning from the past, not rethinking the brand. Let's bring the brand close to DNA. And that was our first initial thing to that journey that it's Max Freelight.
Shortly after this, Oakley started collaborating with some very important athletes, including Michael Jordan and Dennis Rodman. And I just want to ask Brian, like, can you talk about, look at that image. But yeah, can you talk about how those partnerships came about and why they were so important to Oakley?
Athletes have always been important to the brand when you think back through the history of it. Even those early days, we had a thing called Factory Pilots. Yeah. And they were very much where we would get our insights. And just as we're here at ComplexCon and you talk about counterculture and subculture, they were an inspiration for what the brand did in sport. And so when you think about through the 80s and certainly as you get into the 90s and the heroes of sport back then, I mean, the Oakley roster was basically a who's who of athletes. I mean, in basketball, obviously we had Michael Jordan and Dennis Rodman, but we also had like Reggie Miller playing in them. In baseball, it was like Tony Gwynn, Mark McGwire. It was like a who's who in every roster. I mean, all the way down to, people know us in football now with Patrick Mahomes, but we actually used to work with Jerry Rice too, before Shields even existed, where they would come in. And it was really about eyewear protection and what it meant. And so as you start to get into the brand was very much coming from sport performance and those literal things of in competition and things like that. But you started to see things like X-Metal and Romeo and Mars and things like products like that, where guys weren't wearing them just on the field anymore. So what did that mean as a brand? And it was really important for us to get those insights beyond just the performance in sport, but also what it meant to them in life and culture.
Yeah. And just to complement, I think the beauty of like Jordan helps us, you all know that he helps us to build this brand in a way that was like unprecedented before. And the cool thing to actually talk about is that Jordan was coming to our office, our interplanetary office, and he would spend time with the crew over there helping to build products, talking about the future of the brand. So we didn't consider him actually as an athlete of the brand. He was far more than that. And later, I think he was a part of our board of directors for many years because he was a part of the brand. So since the early days, we believe a lot on that, on athletes being a part of the brand and helping us to build the brand.
Speaking of that, and just kind of athletes wearing the glasses beyond like the court, this meme is very popular. It's from The Last Dance. Where isn't he wearing the eye jackets?
He's wearing E-wire.
Oh, okay.
Or A-wire, I should say, at that time.
So yeah, when this came out, everybody was paying attention to it. I'm just curious, did it have any impact on Oakley as the series was playing?
Yeah, I mean, it was super interesting. You know, they say that trends run about 25 years. And so the brand of the 90s was having that trajectory anyways. We saw it starting to show up in a lot of rap videos and things like that. We saw even some of our contemporary products show up on Lil Yachty. Mm-hmm. And then Last Dance came out. And, you know, I think so many things helped put that on the map. I mean, the pandemic was going on. Everyone was inside watching The Last Dance. And it was like an Oakley commercial. I mean, you had Jordan in pretty much every piece of eyewear. You had Rodman in there, obviously celebrating the 6 rings. So coming out of that, there was a lot of hype going on about, I mean, we saw it all the time. People, what are those glasses Jordan's wearing? What's this one? And people reposting it. And certainly, like you say, with Jordan on the bus there, that thing became a meme that everyone was reposting. And you'd see all the comments about like, what is that? What glass is that? And then it as people all saw those Jordan ones, it was like you went down the list and it was like Oakley, 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 Oakley. So it was crazy to see how it had an effect on the brand and where we are today.
And it served as an inspiration as well. Like, I think that some of the kids, they didn't leave this period of time, right? So for us to bring all that context with Jordan in the forefront was a gift to the brand.
And today, Diamond, I love your top, by the way.
Thank you.
Is that Y Project?
Yes, it is.
I was about to buy that.
Okay, that's girl.
So Diamond is currently an Oakley brand ambassador, and I love you're wearing the Mars, right?
I am.
Those are so cute.
No, these are amazing.
Yeah. So talk to me about just kind of your memories of Oakley as, you know, a younger person and how it felt to join the brand.
Yeah, I mean, as a younger person, I come from a family of professional athletes. My dad played in the MLB for 13 years. My brother plays currently. And to Brian's point, I mean, growing up, my dad was playing in the 90s, early 2000s, so all of the who's in sports were competing or just walking around in Oakley's. So that's really my earliest memory of the brand, is just seeing guys like Michael Jordan and Mark McGwire specifically, like in the baseball realm of things, in these glasses that just looked so cool. My dad played in them, and then on into the future, my brother ended up playing in them, so I never really had an opportunity to compete in them until I got struck with a situation. I got diagnosed with an eye condition, and because of that eye condition, I was forced to have to wear protective lenses on the court. Anybody that knows basketball players and their swag, goggles is just really not it. So I was forced to kind of find a way to kind of find something that fit my swag and who I was as somebody who, you know, takes their appearance very seriously. I was not about to be out there looking like Horace Grant, so shout out to Horace, but I had to find a way. So, you know, I found myself kind of reflecting. I'm like, man, what can I do? What can I do? And I was like, I could just put a clear lens into the radars, which is what my brother was playing in at the time. And I walk into the Oakley store on Michigan Ave, and I'm like, I need these, and these. Y'all don't pay me any mind. I'm about to do some really crazy stuff. I put these glasses on. I start running all through the store, jumping up and down, because I just need to see if they'll stay on my face. Eventually, I landed on the radars. And then from then, I played a full season in them before the partnership came to be. And, you know, thankfully to guys like Brian, Kyle, you know, I was able to find myself affiliated with this brand that's kind of just been a part of my life without even knowing it. So it's been a really seamless transition. And thank you to both these guys, Brian and Kyle. You guys are amazing to work with. And, you know, I've just really enjoyed my time with the brand so far. And I can't wait to see where we can take it.
Bobby.
Yes, Aria. Hi.
You grew up in Southern California.
I did.
So obviously Oakley has, I'm sure, a very special place in your heart. Talk to me about like what you remembered about Oakley as a kid and a teen and what the brand meant to you.
Yeah, how many of you grew up in Southern California like me and have fond memories of Oakley, right? So, and I guess this isn't just region specific. I think just global youth culture has always had this intergenerational love affair with the brand of Oakley. I love what Diamond said about it was just always there. Right, I love these brands that almost become institutions where they're hidden in plain sight. It just always existed. It was sprinkled around my environment and my culture, and even if you weren't cognizant that was a brand that was screaming out to you the way that like a Swoosh shirt stripes would on a pair of shoes, you just always knew that there was Oakley in the room somewhere. And what Kaya was saying was that really struck me was he was saying that product sometimes materializes out of these universes that we build. And my universe in the 80s, growing up in Southern California, was very much inspired and affected by, and I think for many of us, you know, what was going on with like the color palette, a lot of neon colors, Saturday morning cartoons, the Memphis group, the way that they're influencing architecture and design. There was a lot of colors. There was a lot of questioning and challenging a lot of the brown tones that had come before. So when the streetwear, which at the time was largely more centered around surf, was leaning into neon colors and these rainbow hues, Oakley came along as like really this status symbol, this social badge where you wear it on your face and it accentuated the rest of your apparel and your outfit. And so it was just one extra nod of these glasses are rather expensive. They're a little bit out of reach. But they also said something about the wearer because they looked so different. They responded so fervent, like I think diametrically almost opposed to the design that was coming up from the generation before. And to me, that's what Oakley's always meant.
So I wanted to talk about a couple of key styles that, it's funny, I saw someone on the ComplexCon floor wearing the Medusa. And yeah, I just see there's a few key styles. And so I wanted to get into a little bit of like history behind them. Let's talk about, well, first let's talk about the over-the-top sunglasses. Brian.
I mean, what can more can you say than they go over the top of your head?
Yes.
But I think when you start to think about it, there's another philosophy we like to talk about, which is if you remove the logo, how do you know it's Oakley? Mm. And I think certainly as you think about this, you certainly don't need a logo to tell it's Oakley, even though there's a little logo on back. Mm-hmm. And it came about because Olympics and things like that, and a lot of the federations where they limit you on how big you can make your logo. One of the things as we went into Sydney Olympics was how do you make something so disruptive that this was the rebellious side of Oakley where we said, we're gonna make something so different that you don't even need a logo on there. So basically, you know, you can get into like, well, we're gonna do the temples crazy, the ear stems crazy, or the, you know, the center front, things like that. When you showed up with this thing, I mean, you said you spotted it on the floor. This thing stands out no matter what the details are on it. It was something very different for the time. So when you think about over the top, these are the things that we like to say, if you remove the logo, how do you know it's Oakley? And you talk about those styles in Last Dance and things like that, and Mars, Romeo, Juliet, all those X-Metals, over the top. The interesting thing about some of those products that everyone was like, wow, those Oakleys, those are the craziest things out there. They don't even have a logo on them. And I think that's just a testament of when the brand's working at its best to live up to the DNA, we don't need to put a logo on it. Yeah. And I think there's other touch points of how do you get that hype out there and how do you make people realize that it's Oakley? But the important part is just, you know, we put this conversation together was how do we get that, live by that DNA, not just of what we've done in the past, but as we move forward in the future, when you talk about, you know, brands that have lasted this long, we got to keep working that way if we're going to be here 50 years from now.
I wanted to talk about a couple of other styles. I mean, the style that Diamond has on, like that leather integration into sunglasses, I'm sure was incredibly like innovative at the time. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, to be able to put that leather on, I'm sure, you know, some of you have seen eyewear where it's wrapped in some type of textile or things like that. You can usually see someone's folded it over and how they sewed it on or something, or it got glued down or it starts peeling. The amazing thing is when you put a pair of Mars in your hand and you look at it, you cannot find the seam of how this goes on there. And the stitching details was really more of a decorative detail to give it that elegance. But as far as like how the leather is attached, it was very sophisticated how we got on that on there. Until this day, it's super funny. I do these tours at work, and I was like, as I talk about Mars, I'm like, I don't even know to this day how we really got those on there so that you cannot find the seams of how that leather went on there. But that gave it that new sophistication. If you think of Jordan, Brad Pitt in Fight Club and things like that, or Diamond wearing it here, where it went from, oh, all of a sudden we were making this very, very sport performance eyewear to like, wow, here's this piece that's made out of titanium and it's got grain leather on it.
And then we just have to talk about the Medusa because it's such an interesting style and I'm just curious about it myself. So yeah, how did that come about?
So Medusa's the one where we talk about, you know, the brand was coming from sport performance. And so people go, well, what's the performance in that? But there's another creed and philosophy we use, which is designed for the future, delivered to the present. And so when you look at those things like over the top Mars, you know, and how a lot of brands operate now and you go, oh, here's the style such and such is doing. We need to make a style like this. That's a cat eye-ish or something like that. When you look at these styles that have become iconic for Oakley, over the top Mars, X-Metal Romeo, and said, oh, well, what do you think inspired that? It's like there isn't another brand out there that did it. It was having that vision. So when you got to Medusa, people would say, well, what was the piece that inspired that? And basically the story is that, you know, design for the future, deliver to the present, as you saw in that first Max Fearlight commercial, there was a vision set of what we wanted the brand to look like. So for our founder, he looked at it as like, I wear my New Era baseball caps every day. A lot of people have caps on. Bobby wears his cap. This was just Jim's vision, our founder's vision of what does a future baseball cap look like? And it's not saying, well, let me decorate a baseball cap. He was like, what's the future cap look like? And it's not a baseball cap. So as he crafted this, it was this crazy thing he came up with that's like, okay, this is what the cap of the future looked like to him. And he wore that. Guys who know me know, or people who know me, I wear my New Era hats every day. This was his New Era cap.
Another style that I've noticed is trending on TikTok now is the Oakley Blade 2.0 watch. Do we have that image? Okay, there you go. It's really good. Are y'all getting back into watches?
You know, we get asked all the time, and you know, it's the Blade watch, Time Bomb, that was our first watch, the Time Machine. We see all these people gravitating towards our watches, and it's funny because the stuff was well ahead of its time back then. And so, you know, it's unfortunate that it was so ahead of its time that they never took off like they could have because they were so progressive. Blade was super interesting. Obviously, when you think of a saw blade and then you look at this watch, you can pretty much see the inspiration for it. But this is the way the brand looked at things. Like I was saying, it's like our inspiration wasn't to go, oh, what other brands' watches styles are trending and let's make one like that. It was like, let's use a saw blade as an inspiration. Now what would a watch look like if it was inspired by a saw blade? And that was the way the brand thought. And so when you start to think about creating these things that were so distinctive and different than anyone else, it was pulling inspiration from not from other things in the category. It was creating that vision for it. As far as us getting into watches, probably a bigger conversation we have to have as a business because it does require a lot more tooling to bring a watch back to life than it does eyewear.
I feel like Diamond's pushing for that.
I'm pushing for all accessories. Mm. I'm pushing for all the dope. Bring it all back.
Yeah.
I think it's amazing, but we'll see.
So talk to me, Diamond. Like, so when you joined Oakley, were you able to go through the archives? Like, was it like being a kid in a candy store? I'm curious.
It was 100% like being a kid in a candy store. The first tour I took through the Icon was with Brian. And if you ever get a chance to do it, and Brian is your tour guide, that's a blessing. So right away, you know, just his ability to storytell and just talk about things like the design and inspiration was all very much in alignment with, again, who I am and what I do. I have not had access to the archives. It's a very exclusive
That's
thing to have access to. Trust me, you would know if I did, all of you would know. But there are things like Mars and some of the stuff that they bring back that they always dial me up with and make sure that I have on hand. So, you know, again, it's just a testament to the brand and the demand that's still there for things that have been done, you know, in the past, but are still very relevant in the present.
And we're looking at your images, and I know it does feel like you're very stylish, and it does feel like, in general, there's people are trying to put more emphasis on what players are wearing in the WNBA. So why is style important to you? You know, why do you think it's something that you focus on for your tunnel look that we see obviously in the NBA? And do you think it's something that will continue to get more attention?
Yeah, I mean, I was a private school kid. So anyone who knows, you know, wearing that uniform every day gets to be pretty redundant. And so I just always look forward to the chance when I could have full like autonomy over my appearance. And then I got to a place where I was like, okay, what do I want to look like? It's not masculine, it's not feminine. Like, how do I find this little in-between pocket that feels authentic to me? And so everything that I've done in terms of my fashion has also happened in simultaneously with me growing to know myself better as a woman. And so, yeah, I mean, I definitely see an uptick in terms of fashion and sport, specifically in basketball. You know, how many of us are, you know, checking out league fits or whatever just to see what our favorite players having on. But, you know, I hope to continue to elevate and put myself in a position of being seen as one of the premier athletes that are, you know, putting it on at a high level and performing at a high level. That's most important.
Yes. So this is a big cultural moment, especially for anyone who cares about Complex. And when Pharrell wore the custom razor blades, they were, yeah, customized by Jacob. Those are so good. And then we saw recently that Drake purchased them from the Jupiter auction for about like $63,000. I want to get your insight on this, Bobby.
Oh, whoa. Me? Okay. Yeah.
Because you're an observer of culture.
Yeah.
And also, you've been in a position where someone who's important has worn your brand.
Sure.
Well, first, let's just talk about that, like, when a celebrity wears a brand, how you respond, or, like, when, yeah, how do you take advantage of it?
I mean, Pharrell and Drake, you can't get bigger than that. We just worked with BBC on an anniversary project, mm-hmm. too, so we understand the magnitude of what it means to work with celebrities and personalities and notable figures, and really, I think, on a top level, they personify the brand in a way where they feel relatable and human. Sometimes it's hard, especially in this culture and generation, to support corporations blindly and groups not knowing their ideologies or their politics or how they have what their perspective is on the world. But if you can see it through the eyes of a celebrity that you connect to, then that brand feels a lot closer to you as an individual and as a human. And so really, you know, I think most of us, if not all of us, see a little bit of ourselves in some of our favorite celebrities, whether it's warranted or it's valid or it's not, right? And so the celebrity thing is very real. I think it can be very quite impactful as a marketing mechanism. It's also an interesting question for someone like me, the generation of streetwear we came up from. For a celebrity to wear your brand, it was almost the death knell. It was something that we were trying to avoid. And so it's interesting 20 years later to look back on it and realize how much celebrities have permeated and infiltrated, in a way, youth culture and youth fashion so that it's almost indivisible. Your brand cannot get to certain levels anymore without some kind of a celebrity, whether it's an influencer or someone on an A-list, to be wearing your brand.
So we're going to talk a little bit about the now and the future with Future Genesis. So tell me about this, Kayo. Like, what is Future Genesis? Why did you think it was important to, you know, produce this extensive commercial to kind of reorient the brand for 2023?
Yeah, as we talked in the beginning, I think Oakley has always been a brand that project for the future and deliver to the present. And as the old Max Fearlight advertising that you guys have seen, we realized that we started that whole journey, actually, Brian and I, trying to create a context for people inside the organization. Because if you ask each of the individuals that are there, what is Oakley, they know it's based on brutalism. They know that it's a brand that it's forward thinking. But each one of them would give us a different interpretation. And we thought to ourselves, what if we think about Oakley being a trilogy of movies? And the first one, very technical. The second one, we go with the time that was like we blew things up with X-Metal and everything else that you have seen on Max Fearlight commercial. What is the third one? How do we create the context for people to actually dream the same dream and actually the context for product to do their job, for marketing to do their job, to march towards the same direction? So that's how we started this whole work for what you guys are gonna see, that it's called Future Genesis. This guy and the brand are gonna evolve in a way that it's abrupt, but it's very close to DNA. And we are creating a whole universe around that journey that you guys are gonna see now firsthand, the two teasers of that story.
Yes, let's play the teasers. Dad, look.
Get back to the bunker. Maxine, get back to the bunker now.
Get back to the bunker. Maxine, get back to the bunker now.
That was great. So I'm curious, Brian, like after you all produce that, how does it trickle down to product? You mentioned it a little bit earlier about wanting to create innovative pieces just as you all did 50 years ago. But yeah, talk about how something like that, how it translates into what we see as a consumer and buy.
You know, when you look at what's going on in fashion and you look at the runway shows going on and all these spectacles thing other brands are putting on, we're not really a brand that does that. And just as you go back to 1992 and Max Fearlight, it's an opportunity for us to showcase the brand. And so it really gives us a platform of not only showcasing things that may or may not come out in the future, but it also gives us an inspiration to predict the future. It may inspire technologies, it may inspire design languages, may inspire color palettes or anything like that. At the same time, now with digital and the meta world and things like that, we can showcase it where we never were be able to back in the day where you had to like wait 3 months for a magazine to print and for it to come out, or you went to a trade show back in the day and it wasn't until 6 months later you saw what actually got debuted at the trade show. Now with social and all these avenues, we can be more progressive than we ever were before, whether that's in product, technology, comms, or anything like that. And even just with our athletes, of like giving them a home of like, how do you express yourself, or how do you see yourself fitting into this universe, or even partners we work with.
Speaking of partners, I feel like we have to talk about some of the recent collaborators, particularly Braindead, because I think they've done an excellent job of kind of, this is a satisfied collaboration, but if you go to the next one, yeah, we have these sneakers, that people, the market's been very excited about. Can we just talk about, you know, working with Kyle and Braindead and how that has impacted the brand and why you all took, I don't know if it'd be a risk, but you said we want to get back into footwear in a big way. I love yours. What are those called?
They're the mules. They're the best.
Oh, they're cute. They're
super comfy.
You know, when you talk about Kyle, it's what you saw there, as Kyle mentioned, you saw Max and then Maxine, his daughter. And I think a lot of parallels going on of this next generation of that's finding all these old Oakley product. It's very much parallels, you know, Diamond and her dad playing in Oakley. Kyle was very similar. You know, we asked Kyle about like, what inspired you so much about Oakley in general? And he was like, when I was a kid, my dad would come home with Oakley stuff all the time. And it was so cool. And then now it's just like, you know, as the trends started to come back around or people started to find all this old original Oakley footwear, he was like, man, this stuff is, people aren't making things like this even now. And it was 20 years ahead of its time. So when we talked about, you know, partnering with someone, or how do we filter our collaborators, whether it is a Satisfy or Braindead, Future Genesis has been great because we go, okay, who are the right partners who fit this storyline of two generations coming together and what their different perspectives on the brand are, regardless of whether it's an athlete or a collaborator like Kyle and Braindead.
And we'll end things with you, Bobby. You can wrap it up for us.
Okay, let's do it.
You're always surprised.
You know, honestly, I just love, I'm a part of the audience. I'm listening, and it's been so informative. It's a real honor. I think we're all really, 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 we should all be honored and flattered that we can listen to this. This is great. You guys are amazing.
Yes, it's great information.
You guys are amazing.
Great information, for sure. But you have a friends and family collab with Oakley.
Yep.
And I guess... Which these look really cool.
Yeah, these are the eye jackets, the original eye jackets. When Oakley and us we've been good friends and family for a while now, and have been sparring back and forth, talking a bit about the story, Future Genesis, and when they said, "Hey, we can work on a project together," I really wanted to select this specific glass. You know, this glass came around when I was coming of age in the 90s especially, and it really embodied that generation. This was the Jordan from that ad, right? Like, this was what Jordan's wearing in his profile. But it was also, for a lot of us in action sports, growing up in Southern California especially, you know, that bug-eyed wraparound look that informed Arnett and Dragon, a lot of snow goggles, snow brands were doing at the time, that was also very much inspired by what Oakley was doing. So it was just, you know, we had to go with that glass. We had that style, that classic white. Also, it was ubiquitous when we were coming of age. So this is the glass. Oh, thanks, Kyle. Yeah, there it is.
Cute. So to end things, I think we're going to ask everybody, what's your favorite Oakley style? Is it the eye jacket for you?
For me, it's probably the razor blades, to be quite honest.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I wasn't going to do them again. Yeah, look at this guy. We already found our model. Yeah.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
We have a special guest.
Yo.
Kerwin, sick. Hey, please.
I don't think. Hello? How you guys doing? So I wasn't listening in. What were you guys talking about?
We were talking about our favorite Oakley styles. What's your favorite Oakley style?
My favorite Oakley style, probably the T-Pain glasses from 2005. Mm. And this Medusa hat, probably. I wear this one a lot. Mm-hmm. But yeah, what are yours?
I like the eye jacket. I think it's classic.
This is true.
Yeah, clean,
yeah.
Cool.
I like them a lot.
For sure, they look good.
I would really appreciate a round of applause to Brian Takumi.
Thank you, everyone. We have to go.
And we really appreciate you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Oakley.